Today, it's my privilege to introduce our chapel speaker, Dr. John M. Perkins. I remember when I was a student here at Ozark, my very first introduction to Dr. Perkins was reading a book that he had written for one of my classes. And through the years since, I have only grown in my appreciation for Dr. Perkins. I was at a book conference a few years ago, and there was a book for elementary children called Great Heroes of the Faith by Dave and Nita Jones. And in that book, it tells the story of many of the great heroes. You think of John Wesley, you think of Polycarp, and meant to inspire young believers. Most of the saints in that book are of days gone by. They're dead. They're with the Lord now. But there's a chapter in that book on our speaker today, Dr. Perkins. And we are privileged to have him here. I want to tell you just very briefly three reasons why I'm so grateful for Dr. Perkins and his ministry. One of the reasons that I admire him is his courage. You may know his story. Born in 1930 in Mississippi, sharecropper's son, fled the state at the age of 17 when his brother was killed, murdered by a town marshal. Went to California, vowed never to return to Mississippi. But there in California, he met the Lord. And after his conversion, sensed the Lord calling him to go back to Mississippi to share the good news of God's love. Now, he returned in 1960. You'll remember from your history, that was in the thick of the civil rights movement. And Dr. Perkins himself was a leader in that movement. And so he endured harassments and beatings and imprisonment. And he paid a price to obey Jesus and to follow Christ's call on his life. And I admire that courage. I also admire his hard work. One of the things we're trying to instill in you as students here is to make every day count. You know, life is not a practice run. This is your one and only shot. And he has made his life count. He grew up in poverty, and Dr. Perkins has a heart for those who are in impoverished areas, a heart for the underprivileged. And so he and his wife, Vera May, through the years have worked tirelessly on their behalf, started a vast number of ministries. These ministries do things like tutor kids, and they have Good News Bible Clubs for kids, and they have technology centers to provide skills for people. They have health centers and church planting efforts and summer day camps, college scholarship, community development, all kinds of things. Not only has he tried to give a cup of cold water in the name of Christ, but he has encouraged others to do so. He has authored 14 different books. These are books that are largely on community development and biblical justice and racial reconciliation, ministry to the poor. In fact, I'll just mention this one that you can find out in our lobby, Letters to a Birmingham Jail. This is his newest book, $10 out there. Wrote this with John Piper and Matt Chandler, and I think you'll be blessed by this as he encourages others to serve in the name of Christ. In fact, back in 1989, Dr. Perkins, there in Chicago, founded the Christian Community Development Association, 37 founding members in 1989. Today, there are over 7,000 individuals in 600 different churches and businesses in 100 cities across the country that are serving others in the name of Christ. And he has worked hard, labored tirelessly, and I admire that. But the last thing I'll say here before we bring him to the stage is this. I appreciate his faithfulness. We live in a day and age when there are too many Christian leaders who do not finish well. And Dr. Perkins here is still running his race with perseverance. He and his wife, Vera May, have been married for 62 years. Yes. And Dr. Perkins is 83. And what you're going to discover this morning is he can still preach. And you're going to be blessed here today. There is no retirement for this good brother, no rocking chair on the porch. He's going to bring us the word. I do want to mention as he comes to the stage, you'll have opportunity to get to speak with him at lunch at 12:30 in the upstairs of the MPB in the West Mezzanine in the multipurpose building. Grab your lunch in the caf, bring it into the gym, and it'll just be an opportunity to talk with this good brother, question and answer time. But right now, he's going to preach to us. Would you welcome to the stage Dr. John Perkins.
It's great to be here. Appreciate you very much. Very kind. Let me read the scripture here this morning.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and this life was the light of man. And the light shined on in the darkness, and the darkness could not put it out. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came to bear witness of that light, which was the true light that lighteth every person that comes into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. And I'm going to skip down where it says, and this Word was made flesh and dwell among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The incarnated life of God, the burden of God, is that we might hear his word. I think we have made God too small, and I think that we have reduced him down to meet our own needs. And in that, I'm seeing the world becoming full of addiction. Addiction to themselves in life. You would ask people, what is the major problem in society? It's addiction. It's addiction to sex addiction, eating addiction, all the addiction, drug addiction. We are over-focused on ourselves. And that's a dead-end street. Jesus calls us to follow him. And he said, if anyone come after me, follow me. Let him deny himself. That's not abandoning of self. That's putting yourself in the body of Christ. It's putting yourself into Christ. He says, come unto me, all of you that are burdened and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me. I am meek and lonely at heart. You shall find rest unto your soul. This so-called prosperity, name it and claim it, is a myth. It's anti-God. It's anti-God. In our world, you don't serve God for what you can get. You serve God for what he accomplished, both in the creation, but greater yet in the redemption. That he was incarnated God, and he came because of injustice and sin. Because justice was the absolute motivation for God's redemptive love. The Bible, the reason he so loved us that he created us to bear his image and his likeness in the world. And sin marred that image and turned us onto ourselves. And that we have lived with those lusts, the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. If anyone come out, let him forget about himself. Take Christ as Savior. And so the burden, what is the solution to this problem as far as God is concerned, is to know this God. That's the burden of God, is to hear this voice of God, to hear this word of God. All things were made by him, and without him not anything. The prophets, all of the people calling us to hear God's word. And this word made flesh. Even the Old Testament law couldn't do the correction that was necessary. Paul says, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending the only begotten Son. And in the likeness of sinful flesh, condemning sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law and all of that might be fulfilled in us. We have lost the understanding of justice, and the most hideous justice in the world, injustice in the world, is to enslave people. That's the very picture. And America lost its moral advantage with the first slave ship. And we haven't been able to see that as evil in our world. And then the church reinforced that evil in the world. And even in the civil rights movement, as you go all the way back, you go all the way back to Wilberforce. You go all the way back. It was the church that had to change because it accommodated. It pretended that it had God. It did have God. But we compromised on justice. The thing that's driving me now, there is a new people emerging in the world. And I think it's because we understand the incarnation in a different way. I think we begin to understand the fullness of it. There's a new generation coming. And I think the civil rights movement ought to have brought it. And I think all of the so-called cures after that, the poverty programs after that, only further destroyed human dignity. And now we filling up him in jail. We three strikes and you out. Now we done put him up in jail, and the jails are so full, now we got to let them out of jail, but we got to keep them long enough to teach them how to be criminals. And they coming back on the streets. And they killing each other in our world. And people are asking, even the government is asking now, where's the church? Where's the church? And the church has sort of filled itself with this fear. They're accommodating their fear. I hear this all the time. You can't get into the public school. They don't lock prayer out. How can they do that? They done locked a lot of noise out. What is prayer? Prayer is listening to God. Prayer is listening to God. God don't really have to know nothing we got to tell him. He already know that in life. What can you do about the word of God? They've taken the word of God out. The Bible tells us the best place to put the word of God is in your heart. The word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. Train up a child in the way they should go in the word of God. And when they get old, they will never forget it. It's putting the word of God, because the word of God is the power of God. It's orderly too, because faith, the Bible says faith is the basis of our fallen God. And the Bible says faith itself cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The reason Abraham is the father of our faith, he heard the word of God. And he walked out on that word of God, and he believed God. And the Bible says his faith was counted unto righteousness. Well, I heard that voice of God 57 years ago. My oldest son, Spencer, was about 3.5 years old, got me first to a good news club, and then to a little Sunday school that he was going to. I grew up without a mother. I grew up without a father. I grew up without Christianity. I'm not the typical black guy, the Pentecostal guy, the God and all. I didn't grow up in that. And as I get older, I'm glad I wasn't damaged by that religion that didn't have any power in it. That religion that has turned more to selfishness and survival than believing in this big God who said, let there be light. That is the God that shines into our heart. That is the God that brings the knowledge of this God as we look in his face, as we follow him. We done reduced God down to small. It's me. The Christianity, more and more, I see some better coming. This is what excites me. But it's become an extension of individualism, selfish, and greed in a society. But what I see is a new people coming. I'm seeing it everywhere I go. I'm seeing for the first time in my 83 years that people now are beginning to value different and diversity. We're going around the world in order no longer to colonize them, to explore them. We don't want to see people sold on the markets. The hottest thing now is selling little children for prostitutes in the world, as prostitutes in the world. There's a change coming. There's a new people. I don't believe we can turn it back. A lot of folks are fearful. They're using their faith with fear, believing that we can go back to something. I don't think we can go back. I think that God has taken this in his own hand. It is almost like he's creating new churches. Churches that build on multiculturalness. Churches who want to reach across these racial lines. People who hear the gospel. That God was incarnated and is incarnated in Christ. And he's reconciling the world unto himself. And he's given us the ministry. And there's a new generation that's coming and taking that responsibility. They're taking it out of joy. Because they begin to understand what God has done for. We begin to understand this salvation, what salvation is all about. God saves us from our Adam sin. He saves us from our personal day-by-day sin. I like John 1:9. I'm talking about salvation. I'm talking about God taking the burden away from us and releasing us and setting us free so we can serve God. That was the idea of redemption. Not to set us free to serve just ourselves. He even said we're to work for our own hands so we can have to give to others in need. This myself is not the end. He says for me to love him with all my heart and all my soul and all his strength, and then to love your neighbors as you love yourself in life. Well, I heard the voice of God in that incarnated message 57 years ago. In a little holiness. That's why I believe in the Word of God, to teach the Word of God. There is no substitute for the teaching. This is the life. The gospel is a central message about the truth of God. It's the incarnated God. I heard that message when Paul said, I have been crucified. Why are you behaving, Paul, the way you behave? He said, I've been crucified with Christ. My sin was forgiven on that Damascus road. But nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. That's a mustard seed faith. That's a faith, you know, I hear people move. It's a mustard seed faith. Abraham is an example of the mustard seed faith. And he served God about 50 years. And then he came to the time it says, Abraham believed God. And that when his faith was counted for justice and righteousness. And I know he said to Abraham, you'll do right. And the Bible said Abraham became a friend of God. And that's what he wants us to be. Friend of God. So I heard that verse, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yeah, Christianity is the outliving of the in-living Christ. It is Christ living in us. That is our hope. It's Christ living in us, and he come into us so he can lead us and he can guide us into truth, and that we can do his will. We are saved to do his will. We are saved to be his workmanship. Paul tries to say that so much in Ephesians. He tries to explain it. He said, for by grace are you saved through faith. And that faith is not of yourself, not of grace. It is a gift of God. It's not of our own works, lest anyone should boast. But then he says, we are his workmanship. To think that God has left us here as his ambassadors to tell others the good news of this gospel. Not only just in word, but in words and in deeds in our society. I see this young generation grabbing with this. I said, they are not talking about, you know, they're not still reacting to communism. Our society has got some kind of foolish reaction, but the most communist and the largest population of communism in the world is China, and they got out of budget debt in our society. And we're still reacting from it. We're still saying helping people physically is socialism, communism, it's Obamacare. And people are walking around empty-headed believing that. And they still believe that the government can do what God wants to do and is doing through his people in our society. We are almost mute. Our government is mute. The Tea Party got the Republican Party held captive in our society. And what we have is some political garbage. And the people now is dying and killing each other on the streets of Chicago. And there are churches on every block. Churches on every block in our society. We need to get there to these places and plant new ones. I've heard some of these young folks are going to Harlem. That's good news. They're going there to plant a multiracial church. They're not losing all of their energy on that. Racist stuff. They believe that God has, he told us to go into all the world. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every ethnic group. Teach them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. And lo, I'm with you, even as the... And he said that he's now at the right hand of God. And God is there. And I think he's working now. I think he's calling out right now a people for his name that's going to take on his work, and that we're going to overcome this racism and bigotry. And it ain't no room for that. It's a contradiction to truth in our society. And if we would believe the truth, it would give us something to act upon, because we don't believe it. We don't believe it. We don't believe that racism is evil in our society. To enslave people, to exploit people for your own. That's why he redeemed his people out of Egypt, because they were building pleasure cities for the pharaohs. Boy, when that first slave ship got here, we destroyed our great promise. The greatest promise, the greatest statement in human history outside of the Bible about human dignity was our Declaration of Independence, our Constitution. I hold these truths to be self-evident, that all human beings are created equal and endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. Chief among those rights is life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And we've been talking about civil rights bills ever since then. Because we don't believe it. We didn't believe it. That we were going to make an experience of the kingdom of God. We were going to be one nation from all nations under God with liberty and justice for all. And we can't even get an immigration bill now that affirms the dignity of the people in our society. Y'all got your eyes on the wrong person. We need to cast our eyes upon Jesus. We need to look fully in his wonderful faith. And the cares of this life ought to grow strangely dim in the light of this love and our grace. Christianity is too weak. Too weak. Our faith is too weak. Because it's centered on ourselves in this society. Got to forget about ourselves. We got to concentrate on him, serve the Lord. We got to think about trying to love this God with all of our heart and with all of our soul and all our mind. And it says that if we do that, we'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth fruits in the season. Its leaves shall not wither. And once we believe in too little. Or better yet, our faith is not in the word of God, who is the incarnated God. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is his name here on earth. Peter could say that at the offset of the church. Neither is there salvation in any other name, For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. We got to come back to the Word of God. But it's got to be in works and deed. We got to overcome this retarded language we have. And we got to create a society of love. And we got to demonstrate it. By this may all men know you are my disciples, because of love one for another. In 17 John, he said, the world will know. The world will know by our oneness and our love for each other in the society. We got to be intentional. You can't be homogeneous. It's a sin. Okay, we can be forgiven. I want you to know that. So that's the idea. We get stuck back there and we won't ask for forgiveness. One of the most eternal verses in the Bible says something like this. If my people that are called by my name will humble themselves and pray anytime, any place. Jonah did it in the fish's belly. The fish had to let him out. Because the Bible said Jonah imagined that he was turning his face toward Jerusalem. He was meeting those requirements in that passage. And he humbled himself and prayed. Turn from your wicked ways. God said, I'll hear you from heaven and I'll forgive your sin. Here, let me give one more illustration of this for me, the Word of God. I remember when God called me, I was reading through the Bible, reading through Genesis, and I came to the call of Abraham, and I heard God's call for my life. And I said, God, would you redeem my name? My name was nobody. We was bootleggers and gamblers. And they talked about the Perkins. It was old Perkins. And I said, Lord, would you teach me the Word of God? And if you teach me the Word of God, then I'm going to struggle to do that the rest of my life. Oh, I've been stumbling and falling. But God now has got me speaking somewhere in audience like this, all over the United States and around the world, around the world. God is moving. He's moving in you. I can feel it on this campus. I can feel it in the meeting that we've been in. The questions are different. I don't get the questions now, these intellectual, you got a few little people who don't quite understand, but I understand that. You don't get those kind of a little theological questions trying to see how smart you can be. The question I'm getting from these young people, they're saying, how to? How do we do that? Lord, teach me. I want to know more about it. I want to know more about the culture. I want to enter that culture. We want to be reconciled. We want to be brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. People are adopting children. They're doing all these things. We are being intentional about that. We are to make, Moses was ordered to make the tabernacle, what we make on earth, is supposed to reflect what's going on in heaven. And in heaven, there is this multitude of people who got the land in which they came from. They got their color. They got their nationality from those places. But they are worshiping God together in our society. And that's what he wants us to do. That was the church he sent into the world. That's when he sent the Apostle Paul from the church of Antioch. He told them first to go to Jerusalem. They turned the opening church was a multiracial church. There was proselytes from all over the world, from all of the nations then that was known in the world. Those people was at Jerusalem. And when that 120... when the Holy Spirit came to live in us and to form the church, you got to know that. There are two aspects, probably more aspects, but two. One thing, there's the individual, and now we done extreme individualism. And then there is the church, and the church houses the truth of God, and no one person has the truth of God. If one person tell you he got the full truth of God, you better run away from him. He's a cult leader. The cut leader, the truth of God was committed to the saints. And it was committed first to the apostles, then to the elders, then to the deacon. There's got to be some sense of accountability. That's one of the things that we got to go hard on these new church plants. Otherwise, you're going to get people just ambition going out there establishing their own church, almost in their own name. And these are going to be little cult centers. There's got to be responsibility to each other because the church was committed. The church, the gospel, the truth of God was committed to the saints of God. There is to be the elders. There is to be the deacon. There is to be the overseers, whatever you call them. They was there in order because God gives us truth in bits and pieces. And that truth come together. He don't give everybody the same gift. Neither do he give everybody all of the truth. And we have to learn from each other and be guided by each other. That's what God wants. And I see that church moving in the world. And I'm seeing it here. And I'm seeing that you're concerned about the broken. You're concerned about that. And one of the things that I want to see, of course, the gospel go forth in every form. But I want to see outreach ministries being sponsored by and more accountable to the local church. I know it's good that we can have, our government allows for nonprofits, and that can be good. But some of these are going to exploit the church. And so they need to be on those boards of directors. They need to be people who are deacons and leaders. And those organizations ought to be committed or have a church that surrounds them as a part of their lives. Other you will get somebody who have lived all raggedly. Now they won't have them in the church, and they go out and get them a nonprofit and begin to act in the name of the church. In our society, God wants our character to be shaped. That's what discipleship is all about, so that we can be the kind of change we want to see in our community. Well, y'all are encouraging me. You're encouraging me. We got a project in Haiti there, and we went to a community where the church hadn't ever been, basically. Where missionaries hadn't been. And we're in Fond du Lac, and we're staffing a mission there. It took us 20 years, but we've also established a high school, elementary school. We put the elementary schools in the churches we fit. Now we're putting the high school in a central location. What we need now down there so bad, we need a college in the United States to sort of surround us. I don't know what that looked like, but I bet you we can make it. I bet you we can make it that way. And we could bring the curriculums here, really, and shape some of the curriculum there, but bring some of our methods there and set up, because when the people leave, even there was no high school out in the fields in Haiti. There was all the Port-au-Prince. And once they got to Port-au-Prince, they never would go back to the village. The whole idea of the Christian mission is to raise up indigenous leaders and to train them. And of course, if we can bring them to the United States, it's easy to get them to the United States. But the problem is once they get a PhD to get them back to the village, or become a doctor to get them back to the village, we got to begin to get going, and we got to create these educational centers. And with the media chain, we can get this information. We could do that. If we could get church at schools like this school and others to adopt the villages in a broad way and bring that education there to the villages of our society. And of course, the goal is always to raise up indigenous. Let me close here this morning. This is a thrill for me to be here. It's a thrill for me. This weekend has been just an absolute thrill. I said last night, there ain't many blacks around here. Y'all, that means that y'all got to work harder. Y'all got to work harder, but we need to be working hard. We need to be working hard, reaching out to the people. And we got to go into these little Hispanic strongholds and go in there with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're not leaving it to them. It's the people who have the light is responsible. What we do is go along and condemn the people with the problem. And then talk about how we can't do that. Jesus said, go into all the world. Lo, I'm with you. Lo, I'm with you, even to the end of the world. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for the privilege of being here. I thank you for this institution that trains people to take this good news of the gospel. And I thank you, Lord, that they are erasing some of this conservatism and socialism and putting all that stuff. And let's proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. We don't need that kind of help. Our help comes from you. And that you can lead us. You can guide. Lord, I pray that you would empower the young folk. These who are graduating. Lord, I pray that you'd be with them. And Lord, that they would just join together as they leave here. They would all get to a church, in a, regardless of what they do, that their main place is to be inside of a local church that are equipping people to do the gospel in that neighborhood and in that community so that we can build the moral courage that we need to make a difference. Thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen.